The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it. For he has founded it on the seas and established it on the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false and do not swear deceitfully. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation. Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Church, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Church, we are being invited into the holy this day. Let us enter this moment with thanksgiving and praise, but with respect, knowing that our holy God is in the midst of us this moment. Let us continue together in worship.
Lord, as I think about your goodness and your mercy, I can't help but shout and sing your holy praise. Lord God, our holy God, we come before you this morning with praise, joy, and thanksgiving. We thank you for your Son Jesus, who loves us unconditionally. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, our constant companion. We thank you for waking us up and allowing us another day to praise your holy name. We give thanks for the ability to gather and a small group of FABC to make this video available to the members and the masses. Lord, we give thanks for the minister of Florida Avenue Baptist Church, Dr. Earl D. Trent Jr., and members who have kept us together during the pandemic. As we enter into this service, Lord, we pray for the presence of the Holy Spirit, for strength, for guidance, unity, humility, and that we learn and accept necessary correctness. Bless the minister of music, Lord, the musicians and the choir. Bless the minister of the hour and the message given through you. We lift you up, Jesus, and magnify your name. Bind our hearts and minds in one. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Thank you. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I don't know about y'all, but I am glad when they said unto me, come, let us go unto the house of the Lord. Good morning, Florida Avenue Baptist Church. As some of you may know, my name is Gary Smith II, and I'm joined by my beautiful and wonderful fiance, Ashley James, and we are so glad to be here.
Good morning, Florida Avenue family. We are so thrilled to be able to welcome you to this morning service, especially from the church building itself. After being away for so long, our spirits are so filled by the presence of this space, and we cannot wait to be able to be here with you, hopefully very soon. For me especially, I cannot wait to see so many of your faces, people who have been so important to Gary throughout all of his life.
As we come to worship from our homes, let's transform our current residences into a sanctuary. Let's bring the Spirit no matter where you are. Make a joyful noise. Shout if the Spirit moves you and give a hand clap of praise as you feel compelled, because this is the day the Lord has made and we are so glad and grateful to be here.
Let's not let this connection that this service brings end at the end of that service. Afterwards, reach out to a fellow church member or other family or friend. Share a message about today. Send a text message, a phone call, something to keep everyone going through this difficult time. Remember, a physical distance or separation does not have to be a spiritual one.
Thank you. morning. I want to direct our attention to a passage of scripture, very prominent in the Old Testament. It comes from the book of 2 Samuel, the 6th chapter, and I'll read verses 1 to 11. It says, David again brought together out of Israel chosen men, 30,000 in all. He and all his men set out from Bala of Judah to bring up from there the ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord Almighty, who is enthroned between the cherubim that are on the ark. They set the ark of God on a new cart and brought it from the house of Abimadad, which was on the hill. Uzziah and Aho, sons of Abimadad, were guiding the new cart with the ark of God on it. And Ahio was walking in front of it. David and the whole house of Israel were celebrating with all their might before the Lord, with songs and with harps, lyres, tambourines, sistrums, and cymbals. When they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzziah reached out and took hold of the ark of God, because the oxen stumbled. The Lord's anger burned against Uzziah because of his irreverent act. Therefore, God struck him down, and he died there beside the ark of God. Then David was angry because the Lord's wrath had broken out against Uzziah, and to this day that place is called Perez Uzziah. David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how can the ark of the Lord ever come to me? He was not willing to take the ark of the Lord to be with him in the city of David. Instead, he took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. The ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, for 3 months, and the Lord blessed him and his entire household. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word, and may the truth of his word be sanctified deeply in our hearts and minds. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you for this day and for who you are and who you are in our lives. We pray that as we go through this service, that your word will become resident in our lives. And I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in thy sight. You are my rock and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. On handling the holy. While the moving of the ark to Jerusalem relates closely to the establishment of the monarchy, the story is also a sequel to the capture and return of the ark by the Philistines in 1 Samuel chapter 4, verses 3 to chapter 7, verse 2. The earlier story grew out of an incident when the children of Israel brought the ark into a battle that they were losing in hopes of turning the battle in their favor. In that battle, the Israelites lost 30,000 men, including the two sons of Eli, whose unholy conduct while ministering in the temple at Shiloh brought judgment down on them and the house of Israel. Hence, the ark was captured according to 1 Samuel chapter 4, verses 10 to 11. The Philistines connected the ark with all the bad things that had happened to them after its capture. So they got rid of it by taking it to the house of Abimadad, whose son Eleazar took care of it. And that's in 1 Samuel chapter 7, verses 1 to 2. It had remained there for 20 years. David's two victories over the Philistines and the capturing of their idols cleared the way for the ark to be moved without opposition from the Philistines. The ark was the symbol of the presence of God. Moving it to the new capital was David's first step in making Jerusalem into a religious capital. Jerusalem was where David ruled his kingdom, and he wanted God to reign there also. It was interesting to note that David took with him 30,000 men to recover the ark, the same number that died in the battle that led to the capture of the ark. The house of Abinadab was located about 7 miles southwest of Jerusalem. The ark was placed on a new cart, one that could not have been defiled according to Levitical law. It was accompanied by Uzziah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab. A great celebration preceded the ark on its journey toward Jerusalem. It was like the return of a victorious army. There was singing, dancing, and music. It was not a dry, solemn processional. It was free-flowing, uninhibited, expressive, and celebratory in nature. But the mood was changed suddenly and dramatically by an incident that took the life of one of Abinadab's sons, Uzziah. On the surface, the event seems rather innocent. As the cart was making its way to Jerusalem, it hit a bump in the road. The bump was of some size because it shook the cart, and the ark moved toward the edge of the cart, threatening to fall off. It was at this moment, rather instinctively and impulsively, Uzziah reached out to steady the ark, and upon handling it or putting his hand on it, he was struck down and killed instantly. The event was so dramatic that David stepped back. The Bible says that he was filled with anger and fear. But notice that he withdrew from the transferring of the ark for 3 months, trying to reconcile himself with what had happened. Was it that God was trying to tell him by this event? You see, the Bible says that the ark hit the bump while on the threshing floor. This is odd because the threshing floor was a flat surface. It was specifically prepared to be flattened with no rocks or beaten earth. It was in an open space where it could be exposed to the wind. So what happened that no one was able to see the bump, evidently a sizable bump that shook the cart? All those folks out there, nobody saw the bump coming. So what do we learn about this event? Is there a similar price we pay when we find ourselves trafficking in holy things? You see, the church is a holy place. It is a set-apart place. It's a place where God abides. God gave birth to the church. It is the place where his name is to be revered. The church is where the promises of God are believed and affirmed. It is the place where God's will is embraced and his spirit reigns and moves and equips and empowers and liberates the faithful. The church is where the gifts of God are celebrated and the grace of God is mediated. What this means is that the broadest possible appeal is made that whomsoever will, let them come. And God in no way will refuse them. It does not matter one's past or their present. God is prepared to deal redemptively with everyone's past, present, and future. The grace of God flows freely and lavishly in the church. The church is a holy place. It's inhabited by flawed people, but by its nature, it's a holy place because its founder and husband is holy. The church is the foretaste or the harbinger of the new humanity, a just and right living and reconciled world. I submit to you that maybe God caused the bump on that journey in order to get things right. This is unlike God, you know, to cause the church to hit a bump in order to get things right. When the early church got complacent and confined the gospel to Jerusalem, the Lord sent persecution to get the church beyond Jerusalem. A bump. In the 14th to 17th centuries, when the church became stuck on itself and resistant to change, the Lord sent the Reformation to split the church, to move the church off neutrality. A bump. In our own history as black Christians, when white churches refused to give our foreparents the true gospel, and in the North, when white Christians refused to give blacks room to freely worship, God raised up some pioneers in the faith who laid the foundation for black worship. A bump. In our own day, when churches refuse to reach beyond the sanctuary and provide relevant ministries to the community, then God will raise up churches with funny names while traditional churches starve to death. A bump. And what about the current bump in the road churches are going through vis-a-vis the pandemic? Churches are discovering a whole lot about themselves in this new environment. Am I right? God will cause the church to hit a bump in the road. And perhaps David's moment of reflection and taking a step back, he realized the danger of taking God for granted. The sudden death of Uzziah was a dramatic example of the price we pay when we take God for granted. The ark was absent from Jerusalem for 20 years. And during this time, it was in the house of Abimadab. And the Philistines got from under it because they were uncomfortable with it. They revered it highly. They wanted no part of the ark because they had high regard for the holiness of God. Think about it. Pagan people, the Philistines, had a holy regard for God's ark. What a statement, and what an indictment on those of us in the household of faith when we fail to have the same high regard for the holy as supposedly pagan peoples. What does it say to us when the unchurched, the unsaved, sinners are more attuned and reverent in the Lord's house than those of us who are here all the time? One author tells the story of some thieves. They enter into a church at night to steal some of the church's valuables. And the one thief noticed some of the marble and ivory icons and statues looking in his direction. He delicately turned the icons and statues around so as to not have them looking onto him while he made off with the church's valuables. Ironic, but indicative of his reverence for the church. At least when folks who have never been in the church act out, their excuse is because they haven't been here. What is our excuse when we act out and do any and everything we think we're grown enough to do in the Lord's house? Like Uzziah, maybe we have gotten too casual with the things of God. The more I'm on this journey, I understand more what Jesus meant when he said in Matthew 18:3, unless you become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus knew something about human nature that becomes stale and complacent after the novelty wears off. This is an admonition to become open and trusting and expectant of what God can and will do. Perhaps many of us have become so cavalier and casual about the things of God because we've been at it for such a long time. We have lost any sense of the expectancy of God. We have lost the awe of the things of God. We tie down and nail down everything in such a rote and ordered and predictable routine as though we don't expect God to do anything new and exciting. The Bible doesn't say much about Abimadab's conduct while the ark was in his care, but perhaps his son, Uzziah in particular, who had 20 years to see it, became so comfortable around the ark that in his eyes it went from being the ark of the covenant of God to an ornate box, and from an ornate box to just a box. And he paid the price for it. It lost its significance, and he lost the awe he had for it. Perhaps God wants us to take a look at how we treat his church. Do we treat his church just like another club? Or is it the place where God shows up to meet his people? Do we show no difference in our conduct in the church and how we act on our jobs or in the hood? Are we at ease acting any old kind of way in the Lord's church? Do we feel that it's all right to say and do anything we feel inclined to do in the church, removing all the firewalls that keep safe and proportional boundaries from any of us going too far? And the greatest danger in all of this is that we believe that God will not hold us accountable for the way we treat his church. Some years ago, I was riding the bus in D.C. when I met a guy who had a certain religious tone to his conversation. As we talked, I asked him what church was he a part of, since he informed me he was a minister. He said he was a freelance minister. Well, that was the first time I had heard that. So I asked him, where does he share the Lord's Supper? He told me he has it at his home, alone. I quickly ended the conversation because he was too deluded to understand that the Lord's Supper is a fellowship meal. But more than that, this guy was playing with God's ordinance, a holy thing. To traffic in the holy things of God requires a new attitude, a sane and sober perspective that God is to be taken seriously. To do anything less is to take God and his holiness for granted. And God will not be indifferent to our contempt for his holiness for long. If Uzziah is not proof enough, you remember Saul, don't you? He did a sacrifice that he was forbidden to do when he was told to wait for Samuel. The Bible says that his actions was the prelude to him losing his kingdom. You remember King Uzziah, don't you? He was Isaiah the prophet's friend and mentor. But the Bible says he went in the temple and contaminated the Holy of Holies. And for his actions, he was stricken with a deadly case of leprosy. And Isaiah mourned his passing up into the sixth chapter of his prophetic book when he says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. In Acts 12, the Bible says that Herod was decked out in his finest robe and proceeded to speak with such eloquence that the people declared that he was a god. And Herod believed what the people were saying. He had plastered all around him copies from all the local papers that he sent everywhere about his eloquence. He did not give God any of the glory. And the Bible says that God had some worms on standby that came out from everywhere and ate him up. We need to take God's holiness seriously or suffer the consequences. But check this out. There is something else here. If you're going to handle holy things, you've got to do it God's way. David and Abimadab's sons put the ark on the back of a new unused cart, drawn by a team of mules. The processional had music and dancing and numbers, 30,000 folk. They were having a high time, but it wasn't in accordance with God's will. The ark was supposed to be carried on poles that passed through some rings that attached to the ark. And then it was to be balanced on the shoulders of the Levites who would carry it without bodily contact. Now David either didn't know any better or acted in haste to get the ark back to Jerusalem. His good intentions were ill-advised. He was sincere in his efforts, but he was sincerely wrong. David had a plan, but it wasn't God's plan. David's way was not God's way. God's ways are not our ways, says the prophet. Proverbs 14 and 12 says that there is a way that seems right, but the way thereof is death. Jesus said one day that narrow is the way that leads to life. Few are on that road. Now I know every now and then we have some good ideas, a workable plan. Folks like our ideas. It worked at home. It worked at the office. It worked in the neighborhood. Folks want to see it again. But it's not God's way. According to Ephesians and Colossians, the church is the bride of Christ. He is the Lord of the church. The Bible is God's will for the church. It is our manual for conduct. We are judged by its systems of ethics. The Bible is our organizational standard and our philosophical rationale. The Bible gives us the precedent for everything regarding its maintenance and mission and its methodology. But for some reason, we want to do things our way and not according to God's way. What this says to us is that there is a strict account to be visited on those who handle sacred things with such ease and irreverence. But note what happens when you follow the story to the end of the chapter. After 3 months reflecting on what happened, David went to the house of Obed-Edom, who had possession of the ark. All the while the ark was in his possession, the Lord blessed his household abundantly. But when David got the ark, he led the processional 6 steps and stopped. If there was some significance to the number of steps, then the author would have said he took 3 steps to prophetically symbolize 1 step for the Father, 1 step for the Son, and 1 step for the Holy Ghost. But it wasn't 3 steps. Had he taken 7 steps and stopped, then we could have inferred something had to be completed. But he mentioned that after 6 steps, he stopped. And maybe David got started, but then realized that he forgot something. Perhaps his mind took him back to the time Joshua was leading the people across the flooding Jordan in Joshua 3. And the Bible says that Joshua told the people, beginning with the leadership, consecrate yourselves. In other words, prepare yourselves spiritually. Be sanctified. Be set apart. Separate yourselves and distinguish yourselves from the world. Stop following after idols. Throw off your ungodly ways. Cleanse yourselves inwardly. Stop listening to foolishness and lies. Stop feeding on innuendos and rumors. Return to the Lord. Give him your life and your allegiance. Love the Lord with all your heart, mind, and body, and soul. Submit your way unto the Lord. Present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. For this is the least you can do for all that the Lord has done for you. And when you come into his presence of the holy, don't be like David's wife, Micah. She lost her blessing. She got demoted among David's wives because she had a foul spirit. She was too dignified to praise the Lord. She was so mean that she tried to steal David's joy. But David knew the Lord. God had been too good to him. It was the Lord that brought David from the pasture to the palace. David's praise was an expression and an extension of his total allegiance and commitment to the God. He didn't hold anything back. He was uninhibited. Nobody, not even his wife, could put a lock on his praise. But the Bible said David was blessed. No wonder David could say, "Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Let all that is within me bless his holy name." No longer David can say, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth." No longer wonder David could say, "Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all his benefits." No wonder he could say, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his love endures forever." No wonder he could say, "I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise." No wonder he could say, "Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praises to my God as long as I live." And then he penned that 150th Psalm and he says, "Praise the Lord. Praise him in his sanctuary. Praise him in the mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty acts of power. Praise him for his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with the tambourines and dancing. Praise him with the guitar and the bass. Praise him with the drum and the cymbal. Praise him. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." On handling the holy. Let us pray. Gracious God, our Father, we thank you because you are holy. Indwell us that we too may become holy as you are holy. Cleanse us from the inside to the outside that we may be ever mindful of who we are and to whom we belong. This I pray in the matchless, marvelous name. Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. We're going to open the doors of the church, and if there's one who desires to become a member of this church, either as a candidate for baptism or one who desires to just transfer your membership to Florida Avenue Baptist Church, then we invite you to come. There are directions to indicate how you can do this, making contact with the pastor by online, and that information is made available to you, and we ask that you do so if you desire to become a member of the Florida Avenue Baptist Church. God bless you, and heaven smile upon you. Amen.
We'd like to just thank Reverend Barnes for that powerful message this morning. We thank him for reminding us of the importance of respecting the holy. Powerful nuggets to take us through the week and remind us what it is to be disciples for Christ. We also like to take a moment to thank the Homecoming Committee for that powerful service last week. We thank you for all of your efforts, and we thank the Music Committee for those songs. All of it was such a blessing, and we were blessed because of it. We want to now focus your attention on next Sunday. We will be celebrating Women's Day here at the Florida Avenue Baptist Church. We are excited that Dr. Cynthia Wood, the pastor of the Dayspring Community Church in Atlanta, Maryland, will be bringing the word of the morning. Church, get ready. Women, be excited, because we are just waiting in expectancy for what the Lord will do. We also like you to continue to remember that on Sundays at 9:30 a.m., we continue to fellowship together around Sunday school. And we are so thankful for Sister Lois Jackson for leading the charge and leading our class. We also want to remind you that each Wednesday at 7 p.m., we continue to have Wednesday night Bible study, and we are looking at the life of the prophet Elijah. We are excited to see how God will continue to direct us as we continue to study his word. And then we continue in our prayers. All of those on our sick and shut-in list, we continue to lift up Haiti for their suffering at this time. And we also are praying for those in New Orleans as they continue to repair from the damage from Hurricane Ida. Please continue to keep all of those persons in your prayer. And then we want to remind everyone that it is so important as we continue this fighting the COVID virus, that you continue to receive information concerning getting vaccinated, because that will be very important in fighting the virus. And then also to remember to wash your hands, to wear your mask. Let's keep everyone safe. We just thank you, and we are praising God for your presence this morning. And we pray that these services have been a blessing to you, and that you will continue to walk faithfully in the Lord. And now, as we close, we like to leave you with a blessing of benediction. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory, with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty and dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.